So the first speaker in this session is Michelle Lochner, who is going to tell us about anomaly detection in astronomical data using machine learning.
Awesome. Thanks, Carolina. Hi, everybody. It's amazing to be here at a real conference with real human beings instead of speaking to a blank screen. So thank you so much to the organizers for inviting me. So I'm Michelle Lochner. I'm a senior lecturer at the University of the Western Cape. And I also have a staff scientist position at the South African Radio Astronomy Observatory. And I'm going to be talking about anomaly detection in general, so it's not specific to radio astronomy, although it will feature. And I just wanted to highlight that this is work done in collaboration with lots of great people who I've listed there at the front. This is very difficult for me because I like to pace when I talk, so I'm having to force myself to stand in one place. Okay, so I want to set the stage for why we're trying to do what we're doing. And the first place, I want to basically mention two very exciting telescopes. The first you've heard about already today, the Vera C. Rubin Observatory under construction in Chile, which is going to run its 10-year legacy survey of space and time. And this telescope is really amazing because it's got clever optics, it's got the world's biggest camera, and what it means is that it's got a big field of view, it can go very deep, and it can do this very quickly. So it can essentially make a movie of a big chunk of the southern sky. And so this is an animation of supernova discoveries, so how many supernovae the Rubin will detect. But what's cooler than this, what's a nice bigger number, is to think about the total number of transients that Rubin will detect. Every single night, 10 million times a night, something is going to change. And Rubin will issue an alert. So that's 10 million alerts every single night. And about half of those are actually real astronomical events. So when you talk about velocity, this is really what we mean. On the other side of the spectrum, we've also heard about, and you know, this is something I think near and dear to almost all of our hearts, is the square kilometer array. So this is in the works a few years down the line. This will be the biggest telescope in the world. And we are also facing an unbelievable data rates challenge. Obviously, we all know about the incredible raw data rates, which Rob mentioned this morning. But even the processed data, even after you've done all the hard work of producing images and catalogs, we can have like a billion galaxies to look through. And for many of us who've done a lot of radio astronomy, we're kind of used to this whole being able to download stuff into your laptop and fiddle around with it, whatever. And we've heard a lot of talks already about how that's just not possible. And we really have to change our ways and deal with the size of these data sets. And of course, the future's already here because we have the precursor arrays. So we've got Meerkat in South Africa. We've got ASCAP in Australia, and we've got LOFAR in Europe, and these are already kind of pushing the boundaries in terms of data quantity. So essentially, I wanted to start this talk by reminding us that we are facing a data explosion. And what are we going to do about it? And of course, many of us are quite sold on the idea of using machine learning to try and help automate as much as possible. So this talk is about anomaly detection. And I think we all kind of have an intrinsic idea of what an anomaly is. It's anything that's different, anything that's unusual, that's not similar to the majority of the data set. And now we could split these up into kind of known unknowns. So these are objects that are rare, but we know about them. So an example, for instance, is strong lensing in the optical or gravitational waves. These are rare events, but because we know about them, you know, we may not be able to build training sets to look for them, but we kind of know they're out there and we know how to look for them. They are still very much anomalies, though. But of course, what we're all excited about is the unknown unknowns, the true scientific discoveries, the things that nobody was expecting. And this is what's really exciting when you start to go to enormous data volumes. And I like the example of the pulsar because in 1967, it took a very bright graduate student named Jocelyn Bell Burnell to manually go through all her data and notice something weird. So, and I think most big astronomical discoveries are made in this kind of way. It takes a human looking at the data, noticing something strange, and then following up on it. So the question is, how are we going to discover genuinely new phenomena when there's 10 million alerts a night? When there's a billion galaxies in your data set? How do we automate the process of discovery? And this is where anomaly detection can play a critical role. So I'm not going to go into a whole background of machine learning and how it works, especially because this is a branch of machine learning you don't often hear about, although you have already heard one really great talk on it this morning, which is unsupervised learning. So you don't have labeled data. This is different from the is it a cat or is it a dog example, because we are, by definition, looking for things that we don't know what they look like. So there are a bunch of machine learning algorithms that are designed to operate in this kind of regime. And more or less, they just take the data set, try to figure out what the kind of majority looks like, and identify things that are quite different from those. So two very simple examples, I'm not going to go into details, but on the left there you can see isolation forests, which is an algorithm based on very popular random forest algorithm. And it basically tries to split up the data to try and isolate each point, with the idea being that points that are near lots of other points are hard to isolate, points that are far away are easy to isolate. So it's a pretty simple algorithm, but actually extremely effective for anomaly detection. And on the right there, I've got local outlier factor, which is a density-based algorithm, simply looking for anything in a low-density regime. I've worked on a few other anomaly detection algorithms, some novel anomaly detection algorithms in the past. I'm particularly fond of BADAC, which is the Bayesian anomaly detection and classification algorithm. What's nice about this is it takes into account uncertainties, which, because machine learning is a field driven by industry, is not common. Most machine learning algorithms are not uncertainty aware and don't take this into account. So BADAC is really nice, especially if you're in the kind of low signal to noise regime. And then on the right, there's another algorithm developed by my collaborators called DRAMA, which is a deep learning-based algorithm. Effectively uses deep learning to reduce your data down to a latent space and do anomaly detection in that space where it's a bit easier. So that's also a very nice algorithm, and all the papers are there if you want to check them out. So the key thing that I wanted to talk about here, though, is when Bruce Bassett, my collaborator, and I were originally talking about anomaly detection, wanting to work on this problem, we kind of early on realized anomaly detection alone is not enough, especially if you've got 10 million alerts a night. Just finding that you may end up with 2,000 anomalies to look through. So there has to be another step after the anomaly detection. And what's interesting is that this step is subjective. And that's different from like a spiral versus an elliptical galaxy. We can all agree on that kind of classification scheme. But while many things can be anomalies, not all of them are going to be interesting to you as a scientist. So for example, on the screen, I've got artifacts on the left, which you as an astronomer probably would want to get rid of. And I would be more interested in the real sources on the right. But if you're interested in checking your data quality, for example, you care about the artifacts. You want to know about them. So there's this intrinsic subjectiveness to the second stage, which is, are these anomalies interesting to you or not? And so you need a kind of, almost like a recommendation engine. So something that is able to operate in an unsupervised way, so without much training data, to be able to recommend to you the kinds of anomalies that you might be interested in. And this is a branch of machine learning called active learning. And that is where you combine the raw processing power of the machine learning algorithm with the human intuition, creativity, and expert knowledge. And what I'm really interested in is how we, because my experience with machine learning has made it abundantly clear that we can't really just trust these algorithms to just carry on their own. There has to be a human involved in these final decision-making processes. So the key question is, how do we best leverage the machine learning algorithm to free up as much expert time as possible and use that expert time wisely? And our attempted response to this is called Astronomaly. So this is a very general purpose anomaly detection framework for astronomical data. And you can see on the left there, it starts with what is really a pretty standard machine learning pipeline. It starts with reading in the data. It can work for image data, be it optical, radio, whatever. It can work for time series data. It can work for spectra, features, et cetera. With the caveat, of course, that there are many data formats, so it may require some slight tweaking, but in theory, it can work with basically anything. The next step is extremely important, and it's called feature extraction. And that is where you reduce your data down into something simpler that best represents your data. And we saw a really good example of that this morning in Fernando's talk, where you use an autoencoder to bring, and you can use those as a feature extractor to bring your complicated data down to a simpler set of numbers. And the way you do that is very important, and it will dictate the types of anomalies that you end up being sensitive to. The next step is anomaly detection, and I have a couple of standard anomaly detection algorithms, including a couple that I showed you earlier. But the part after that is what's really critical. So up until now, it's just some Python code running in the background, doing this machine learning. The important step is the active learning, bringing in the human part of this algorithm. And you can see in the screenshot on the right is the JavaScript interface that I built, which allows you to very easily go through your data, label it, and when I say label, I'm not talking about labeling 100,000 examples, I'm talking about labeling maybe like 50 or 100, which only takes a couple of minutes with this interface. But you're basically just telling the algorithm, you're not saying, yes, this is this type of galaxy, or this is whatever other type of galaxy, you're just saying, I'm interested in this. I want to see more of this. And then we built a novel and active learning approach that will improve your anomaly detection and show you more of the things that you like and less of the things like maybe artifacts, for example, that you don't like. And one key point to make here is that within this active learning approach, we included an idea of kind of uncertainty. So if there's a regime in which there is not much labeled data and the algorithm's not really sure and it finds something anomalous, you're gonna see it. So you're not going to miss anything, but you are going to spend less time on the junk that you maybe don't care about. So the code is available. The link is at the bottom. I would be absolutely delighted if you wanted to try this out on your data. It's, of course, still very much in development. So, you know, send me a message when you inevitably get stuck with something. And the paper is out at the bottom. Okay, so let's actually see this in action. So with this data set that I'm working with, this is from the Galaxy Zoo, which is a citizen science project, lots of labeled data, including some objects that were labeled as odd. It's not very specific, but it's odd. And if you look at just, if I take the data and just order it randomly, you mostly see like ellipticals, spirals, kind of boring galaxies. I now run my machine learning algorithm with a fairly simple feature extractor that I built. And I've sorted the data from most to least anomalous. So remember, at no point have I told this explicitly what I'm looking for. This is just what the machine learning algorithm thinks is weird. And I can now go through this data very, very quickly and evaluate each of these objects. So you'll see at the bottom of the screen the numbers are changing. That's because for some things it's like an artifact or it's something that, you know, is maybe just coincidental galaxies or whatever. So I'm changing, I'm telling it how interested I am in each of these. I then run the active learning algorithm and order it again from most to least interesting, but now by the new score. And you see it does a pretty good job of getting rid of the artifacts and just prioritizing the things that I, as a user, care about. So the whole idea is to massively speed up the amount of time that we need to spend looking through the data to find things that are interesting and worth pursuing. This is just to visualize what's actually happening in the algorithm. This is quite hard to do without a pointer, but what you're seeing on the left is the raw anomaly score, just a map of it in some representation of the data space. And on the right is after it's been retrained. So basically, regions where I've ranked objects very highly is very interesting, kind of get upweighted. And regions that I've ranked very low get downweighted. So that's kind of the simple idea. Okay, I'd be completely remiss to not show some meerkat data. So this is the MGCLS dataset, the same one that Fernando mentioned this morning. And again, I've just started it with a random sampling. So you're mostly just seeing ordinary sources from PyBDSF. When I run this exactly the same algorithm that I ran with the optical data, which is kind of cool, I didn't have to laboriously retrain anything. I could just run exactly the same approach and order things from, again, most to least anomalous. You can see it is definitely picking out stuff that's different from the norm. Mostly anything with kind of weird morphology gets picked out. And here's a little wallpaper of, I think these are the top 10 anomalies. So I wasn't as patient as Fernando was, so everything is automated. I haven't manually looked through the data, really. So that you do occasionally see repeated sources. But other than that, you know, it does a reasonable job at very quickly showing you stuff to see if there's anything interesting that you want to look at. Okay. Oh yes, and then one more application, which I can't help show just because they're really pretty. And this is the decals survey. So this is a massive optical survey that's very recently been done. My master's student has been looking at applying Astronomaly to this data. And as always is the case with machine learning, whenever you go from a nicely curated data set to something more realistic, everything falls down. So he spent a lot of time working on improving the algorithm to get it to operate with more kind of raw data, because the Galaxy Zoo data is really beautiful and curated and easy. So I wanted to show you some examples with time series data as well. So this is all exactly, this is the cool thing with the algorithm, is that after you've done the feature extraction, everything else stays the same. So working with transient data, for example, was fine. There wasn't any problem. So I have another student working on looking at anomalous transients in the CRTS data and finding a couple of weird carbon stars, flare stars, etc. But one thing I really wanted to talk about is this application, because I think this could actually be a model for the types of analyses that we can do, especially for something like Meerkat, because Meerkat is really pushing the boundaries of sensitivity. So it's finding things that we have never really seen before. And the problem with trying to apply standard supervised learning approaches is that we just don't have the training data. So an unsupervised approach is definitely going to be more effective, I think. But it's critical that you include that active learning component. Otherwise, the algorithms are fairly useless. So here's a cool example of this. So this is a bright student. She's now a postdoc in Australia, Sarah Webb. And she came to me with this data set of a million light curves, taken from the Deeper, Wider, Faster program. So this is a cool program where they're trying to detect fast transients, so things on like the minute timescale. And this is a regime that hasn't really been probed much in astronomy. So we kind of expect to find things that we haven't really seen before. But she had this big data set, nobody had looked at it, it didn't have any labels, and it was just enormous. And so what she did was she took one field, which was still about 80,000 light curves, and we used a fairly standard feature extraction package. And the key thing is that she applied clustering. So this is an algorithm called HDB scan, which automatically tries to collect together similar objects, basically, so similar in feature space. And when she used HDB scan, she found these big clusters. And some of them, she could basically throw away huge chunks of the data just by looking at a few examples from that cluster. So, oh, these are all artifacts caused by this thing. Oh, these are all just standard stars. We can just throw them away. So she can get through 80,000 light curves, you know, with minimal amounts of human intervention time. And that let her focus on the things that were actually important. So she took kind of the remaining data, things that don't fit into clusters, and ran Astronomaly on it. And it worked pretty well. So she was able to pick out a few known variable stars and make some new discoveries, and also discovers some weirdly behaving flare star. So this was just an example of taking a data set, completely unlabeled, not very much known about it, to actually getting some science results using unsupervised learning. So I do think that this could be a model that we could use going forward. Then this is a nice example, and actually this is an example of where machine learning doesn't work very well. So I think quite often when we give these machine learning talks, we're always like, oh, it's amazing, it solves everything. But actually in reality, there's some problems where it's not the right tool for the job. So the problem here is when Rubin is going to make these 10 million alerts every single night, we need to know if there's anything interesting that we want to follow up. But we need to know in real time. So this is much harder than taking a known data set of light curves and classifying them, for example. We have to be able to do this in real time. So I had this very simple idea of if we had a model for what we expect a particular object to look like a type 1a supernova, and we detect a point that deviates from the model, well, that might be an anomaly. And so this was the idea that Dan Mutakrishna, who's now a postdoc at MIT, worked on. So what you're seeing is a deep learning model using a temporal CNN, making predictions based on previous points in the light curve. And it does a reasonably good job. The problem is that it actually does too good a job. And the deep learning algorithm was too flexible. It was able to basically fit anything. So these are very complicated plots. Don't worry too much. Basically, what you want is for the left part of it to look, the left part of this matrix to look very blue, and the right part to look very red. That means it's detecting anomalies. And the deep learning algorithm didn't really work that well. What worked much better is a good old-fashioned Bayesian statistics approach, where we used a parametric model, we fit it, and we were able to detect anomalies that way. So this paper should be on the archive in the next week or two. The final application I wanted to mention, because this is something I'm very excited about. So this is a very bright postdoc at Manchester. It's great to work with young people who see what you do and then take a look at it and go, oh, I think I could do that better. And they're not completely right. So he, instead of using my very simple features that I use for morphology, he had a trained CNN based on Galaxy Zoo data and used those latent features as features for anomaly detection. And you can just see in the plot on the left that he does massively better. And this is with the CNN trained on a different data set and applied to SDSS. So the idea is that by solving a classification problem, you produce a useful feature extractor for other problems. And although we don't have yet this kind of training data in radio astronomy, I think the idea of representation learning could be really a powerful approach. Okay, so I wanted to finish off. I think I've got 2 minutes left or so. And now that I have all of your undivided attention, I'm going to shamelessly advertise. The first thing I wanted to advertise is the Supernova Foundation, which is a mentoring program, an international mentoring program that I run for women and gender minorities in physics. So here's a screenshot of some of our lovely mentors. So we are always looking for new mentors and mentees. So if you're interested, please check out the website. And finally, I wanted to advertise a postdoc, if anyone's interested in coming working with me. It starts next year. And it's fairly flexible, anything related to Rubin, vaguely related to Rubin or multi-wavelength stuff, and preferably to do with machine learning. It can be difficult to compete with, you know, some of the more well-known universities in the world. So I thought the most sensible thing to do is to just show pictures of Cape Town. And this is an unbiased representative training set, because these are pictures that I took myself. So if you're interested, please send me an email or and check out the website. And of course, you can just send me a message on Discord. And I'm going to finish off with just a couple of conclusions. Basically, machine learning is pretty critical. It's not something that can just be used out of the box for absolutely everything to solve every problem. But there are many problems, like dealing with the 10 million alerts a night, that we just can't really do without machine learning. But I think that we need to really start pushing it to its limits and try to automate things. Well, I mean, not fully automate anomaly detection, but automate a lot of the hard work so that we can make really good use of the expert time. And our attempt at this is Astronomaly, which you can check out there. And of course, I'm just going to add these links to the Supernova Foundation and a reminder about the postdoc. And I think I'm exactly on time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michelle. We have some questions that have come in. One question from Spesihle, who says, have you considered using more than morphology when searching for interesting sources, for example, spectrum?
Yeah, definitely. Astronomical is a framework, and it's very modular, so you can kind of put anything you want in. And at the end of the day, you give the algorithm whatever features you think are a sensible representation of your data. So if you have additional information, like redshift or spectroscopic information or whatever, then you can just add those as features. And it's really important because, like, for example, the Galaxy Zoo example that I showed, the features that I used are just sensitive to morphology. And even then, you know, they're not great. Like that CNN that Mike built is much better. But if anything came up that was a weird color, my features wouldn't pick up on it. So your choice of features is really important. And it does mean, I mean, we do have to know a little bit about the data, even if we don't necessarily know what we're looking for. We may know that, okay, anomalies can be weird in a number of different ways, like morphology, color, spectra, etc. So short answer is yes, you can add anything. But in the first initial paper, mostly just use morphology.
Okay, thank you. And we have another question here from Ben. So if you could please walk to the microphone.
Well, that was an excellent talk. Just a quick question. You mentioned artifact detection in parsing. Has there been any progress in using this anomaly detection tool of yours to auto tag and detect places where direction dependent calibration can be applied? Because we now have all the tools to do the direction dependent calibration peeling, but tools to actually detect where those should be peeled is not quite there yet, not automated.
That's a good idea, yeah. Actually, Spear and I were chatting in passing with something similar. So it's not something I've attempted yet, but in playing with like the MGCLS data, for instance, or a different data set which had much worse DDE effects, it became quite obvious that these artifacts do get flagged as anomalies. And so if that is what you're looking for, then yeah, for sure, you can just flag them and find those kind of areas. But I think I would want to use a better feature extractor than what I'm currently using. So for something like that, where you're just trying to detect that kind of structure, just the PSD, which is one of the feature extractors I have, might actually work well enough for that. Okay. So yeah, it's definitely something you could do.
All right,
we should chat about it.
Cool.
Great, excellent. We have no more direct questions in the Discord. I don't know if there are more questions in the room. No? Okay, then thank you so much, Michelle, for this great talk.